Hey, welcome to Fireside Gaming. I'm Billum, and this is another retro game collecting video. It's been a few months since I've done one of these. I think the last one I actually did was Southeast Game Exchange, which has been 3 or 4 months ago, I guess. But either way, the wife and mine's 12-year wedding anniversary was last weekend, if I get that right, for when this video goes up. And we went out and we did some retro game collecting because it had been a while. So I thought I'd show you guys what we picked up. And I know I say retro game collecting, but I'm going to immediately show you two Switch games. We just happened to pick them up along the way, and I was like, I'll just include them in the video. You know, why not? So first up is New Super Lucky's Tale. This is a 3D platformer-style game. One that the wife and I have both been interested in, but we've just been kind of waiting to see... Pick it up for a good price? I don't know. We just hadn't grabbed it yet. I don't know. I don't really have a good answer for that. You'll see there's a sticker. We didn't get around to taking the stickers off of all of these games yet. Just time constraints, basically. Just hadn't got around to it. But yeah, New Super Lucky's Tale. It looks fun. If you've played it, please mention so. I know there's a normal Lucky's Tale, Super Lucky's Tale, and this one's kind of supposed to be like a revamped version or like a finely tuned version. But yeah. There's the first one, and the next one is one that I was greatly looking forward to, Super Robot Wars T. I have been a fan of Super Robot Wars since Daiji 3 Super Robot Taizen, which is, Taizen is just Wars in Japanese from my understanding, but I played that on the SNES way back in the day through a fan translation by Aeon Genesis, I believe was the translator. So I've been playing these games for quite a while. I played the Alpha series on PS1, the Z series on PSP, as well as MX Portable as well. So yeah, if you don't know what it is, it's just a bunch of robots, mecha series from Japan. Like on the cover here, we have Mazinger, we have, Gunx Sword, or Gun Sword, I guess. There's G Gundam, King of Braves Gal Gaigar, that is Gunbuster. Surprisingly enough, we have... Oh, geez, I blanked. Arcadia. Come on, Captain Harlock. There we go. I think this was the first time he's shown up in the series. He's not really a mecha series, per se. Votoms. I think that mech right there is from Nadia? Or, no, not Nadia, geez. Nadesico. Martian successor Nadesico, I'm pretty sure. I don't recognize that one off the top of my head. But, or this main guy, he eludes me as well. But either way, that was the other Switch game. You guys have seen me pick up other Super Robot Wars games before. I picked up a copy of F-Final for the Sega Saturn a while back, and it still had its trading card and stuff in it. That was an older video. I'll find it and link it if you're interested in that. But now we're actually getting to more retro with Golden Sun, Dark Dawn. This was a pickup of the wife's. She is currently playing through Golden Sun 1 and 2 via... Manual's trying to get away. Via the Wii U eShop releases that we picked up before that went down. And so she wanted to pick up this one as well because she's been enjoying them. I have tried Golden Sun before. I played the first one a fair bit, and despite being a JRPG fan, they never really did it for me, so I don't know, maybe I'll end up playing this one someday down the line, but I have no idea. I have been meaning to revisit the series and see if maybe I enjoy it now, since the last time I played it was 15 years ago. I'm probably somewhere around there. And now we have Eternal Eyes. Now, Eternal Eyes is a PS1 game, but it's a strategy RPG. Now, you look at that cover, and then you look at the back. This is one of those instances of a Japanese game that came out in America, and they Americanized the cover. That used to happen quite a bit. Back in the day, I'm thinking of Mobile Light Force as one of them. Everything I've seen about this game basically says it is a average, kind of mediocre game, but, you know, okay. Oh, this is weird. It has an ad behind the disc instead of, like, background art. I don't know. I've never seen that before, and I thought that was kind of odd. But from what I understand, this game was only $10 MSRP when it came out back in the day. And I was like, huh, I'd never heard of it, never seen it before. So I decided to just go ahead and snatch it. We have another wife grab. This is Neopets, the Darkest Fairy. Now, this isn't actually the first copy of this game we own. The wife has a copy that is incomplete. It didn't have its manual. It had damaged case art and stuff like that. And so she just wanted a nice, complete version. Granted, it is missing. If you were a Neopets fan back in the day, as you'll see here, it says promo card. It does not have that promo trading card anymore, but she was more interested in making sure she had the manual. But she's played this. I watched her play it a couple years back, and it's a fun little, like, action adventure Zelda style clone. Nothing that's gonna blow your mind, but it was perfectly fun, and especially if you like Neopets, or, you know, for a child or something like that, easily worth it. Now here is another Mii pick, and this is Killswitch. This is the first game I know of that uses the cover system that would later be popularized by Gears of War. And I played this game originally on a demo disc back in the day, and then I never got around to actually playing it. I sold it for $7, and I was like, psh, that's worth it. Pick that up for that price, and then finally get to experience this game, which I feel like I do that a lot. I just did my Omega Boost review, and it was just basically me, like, wanting to, like, really tackle a game that I'd played on a demo disc but had never beaten before, which was a lot of fun. If you want to hear more in-depth thoughts about that, I can link it in the corner or whatever. But yeah, this was a similar case of I had it on a demo disc as a kid. I never got to play the full game, but I remember enjoying it. So yeah, maybe it'll get covered on the channel. I don't know. Just have to wait and see. Which I will say, I do enjoy if people comment on games that they want to see played. I take note of those. I put them higher up in priority. Don't get me wrong, like, a comment doesn't make me jump the game to, like, highest priority. I sit down and play it right now. Like, it doesn't do that. But it does definitely put it in the back of my mind where when I'm thinking of something to play, I'm like, oh yeah, yeah, I had a comment about that game. So that's just something to keep in mind while I do these kind of videos. Now we have Sly Cooper, Thieves in Time. Now this is a PS3 game. Some people don't think PS3 and 360 generation stuff, and I think that includes Wii as well, technically count as retro, but I think they do at this point, which feels weird to say and means that I am definitely getting older, but no matter the case, this is actually the last Sly Cooper game I needed. I've only played the first one, but I enjoyed it, and I wanted to play the other ones, and I've picked them up over the last couple of years, and so now I can actually sit down and play through all four Sly Cooper games. And now we have Resident Evil 5, and you're probably thinking to yourself, Billum, how do you not own Resident Evil 5 yet? I do. I have it on 360. I've had it since it came out back in the day. What I don't have is the extra bonus content, which this is Gold Edition, and it includes Lost in Nightmares, Desperate Escape, new costumes, more mercenaries, players, things like that. I picked this up because the 360 version of Gold Edition comes with a code, and it doesn't have the extra content on disc. The PS3 version just has it all right on disc, and you never have to worry about losing it. So the wife and I have been kind of talking about buying on Xbox Arcade, or Xbox Arcade, geez, buying on Xbox the extra DLC for this game, because I've played it before, but she hadn't. And we talked about it, and then I was like, you know what, let's just pick up the PS3 version, since it has all of it right there on the disc, and we never have to worry about it again if, like, the store goes down, or, you know, and our hard drive dies, or, you know, some kind of catastrophic situation. This lets us avoid that, not have to worry about it, it's all right there on the disc. Okay, and next up is Mech Assault 2 Lone Wolf, the limited edition, which I think it means it has some bonus maps and some extra content. I think it's listed here on the back, actually. Yep, two exclusive multiplayer maps, and then never-before-seen footage, an exclusive G4 Tech TV production. Interviews with the creators of Mech Assault 2 Lone Wolf. I actually think that's pretty cool. I'll probably end up watching that because I grew up watching Tech TV, and then eventually it became G4, watching Attack on the Show and X-Play and stuff. I remember there was a game, was it called Arena? I don't remember. But it was basically like a game show style place where they brought in people to play games, and I think Mech Assault 1 was one of them that they had. It was one or two, I don't remember which one. It was probably one, I don't remember. But it was one of the things where they'd bring these teams in and they'd play games against each other, and gosh, I'm trying to remember the host. It doesn't matter. Point is, I'm interested in that. I'm interested in this game. I have Mech Assault 1 already. Yeah, it's split up onto two discs, actually. Normal Mech Assault 2, and then Mech Assault 2 Lone Wolf Limited Edition, which I think that disc just has the extra stuff on it. But yeah, I like mechs. I probably don't need to point that out too much. I've done Gundam reviews on this channel. I've talked about Armored Core extensively. I just did Omega Boost, like I mentioned earlier. I really like my mech games. So picking up another mech game, whether it be Western or Eastern or anything in between, that's always a win for me. And now we have The Chronicles of Riddick, Escape from Butcher Bay. I've never played this. I did watch a friend play through the game, and I thought it looked really neat with its stealth mechanics and stuff like that, so long as I'm remembering the right game. And this is one that the wife was interested in. We both like Chronicles of Riddick, and she likes stealth games and everything like that. And, I mean, I'll probably end up playing this someday as well, but this was specifically one that the wife picked out and wanted to play through, so there we go. I haven't really covered any OG Xbox games on this channel yet, it just occurs to me. I mean, I have an OG Xbox. I did a whole video about buying it and buying games for it and stuff like that. But I haven't actually reviewed one on the channel. I should probably amend that here. Maybe in 2024? I don't know. I'm really bad about, like, planning ahead. But there's that. And then we come to our final game, which is Gunmetal. Yet again, it's a mecha game. Go from, what is it? I think the whole concept is that you can switch from plane to mech, skies to land and all that jazz. Ah, excuse me there. Had a belch. But yeah, it's, I don't know. I can't remember much about this. It was on our list. I knew it was one that I wanted to play, and that's about all I remember, unfortunately. Yeah. I'm sure it'll be fun. It's mecha. I like mecha. Yeah, I know. Not doing this game the best service right now. Another tiny thing I guess I could mention that's like retro related is I bought some 8-bit-o replacement joysticks. Here's one of them, actually. For N64 controllers, you basically hook these into an N64 controller in place of the normal one, and you have a working N64 controller. Because as I'm sure plenty of you know, N64 controllers have this thing about going bad really easily. And this is what an unrepaired one looks like. Sorry, my desk is a mess. But a repaired one, a replacement, looks like this. It makes it more of a GameCube style, and the cool thing about these 8-bit-o, I think it's actually 8-bit-do, but whatever. The cool thing about these is that they are Hall Effect joysticks, so they use magnets instead of scratch pads, essentially, and they should last basically forever. Or at least, you know, your lifespan. That's the idea behind them. So I've done one of these repairs, I've got another one that I still need to replace yet, and I just haven't got around to, but I thought that was kind of a neat retro gaming thing if anyone was interested in that. I think they actually have an entire kit to, like, convert an N64 controller into a Bluetooth Switch controller. But I just grabbed the thumbstick. That's all I was concerned about. And with that, that's this video complete. So, until next time, take it easy.